There. Thank you.
Hey, congratulations. Okay, climb forward here, we got a picture.
Yeah, everybody.
Yeah, we can get him after the picture.
Yeah.
Yeah, get in front, open up your certificate, just hold it in front of you.
You guys. Yeah, Nancy, Steve, you guys wanna come up?
So you know we'll see you. Get up to the front. We might put you on a knee down there.
Did you see Nancy? We wanna make sure you see Nancy. Say, before you go, don't forget your little bags. I already filled them in on all the information, so. You guys will get, take care of it. Hey, Nance, before you guys go, let me just say a couple things, but.
Okay.
Do you mind? Then they can go. Mayor Pro Tem Bloom, if you would allow me to just say a few words about this group.
You have the
just
floor.
Just before they leave, first of all, I'm jealous that they're going. Not jealous about your 14-hour trip, however. I'm sure they filled you in on that already. But I just want to let everybody know that, you know, every year it seems like it's getting more and more difficult to select our six participants only because we've gotten so many more that are interested. Nancy, how many do we have this year? 50 applications, okay, and so obviously the six that you see now are the ones that we've chosen to go. A very hard selection process, there's no doubt about it, but I think this group, just like all the groups, are very talented in their own ways. They have their own talents, and they will, I have no doubt, represent the city of Temple City and the United States very well while they are in Australia. They're going to be in for a great time. I know that you guys have done a lot of preparation work. And so on behalf of the council, we wish you a safe trip, a fun trip, not too much fun, though, because I'm just saying that for the parents. But you know, have a great time. You'll enjoy it. I can tell you from firsthand experience, it'll be a once-in-a-lifetime adventure. And just enjoy everything about it and come back with some good stories. Okay? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Now you can go.
Okay, next on the agenda item 5B, which is the Sheriff's Monthly Activity Update. I believe Sergeant Miranda's here to do that.
Hello, everyone. Okay, briefly, I'm Sergeant Miranda, I'm sorry, Temple Station, Temple City Team. I'm going to briefly explain some of the things we covered in June. Topics would be operations, our community academy. Some of these items I touched on briefly last month, but just kind of an overview of this month. Our area number 11 watch meeting, notable arrests, other activities, upcoming events. First of all, we assisted on a search warrant, and I'll be more specific as we get to that actual topic. We also assisted, did a residential burglary, a probation operation, a transient operation, a undercover operation, and we assisted the Rosemead team. A lot of times what we'll do is we'll assist other city teams, and they in turn will assist us with operations. You'll hear more about that in just a second. Okay, We assisted the Detective Bureau with a search warrant operation. You probably remember the three shootings we had last month here in the city. There was a resident shot into. There was a shooting in the air. We also had a vehicle shot into. There was information developed by the detective. We assisted Detective Bureau with a search warrant. They recovered a handgun, arrested one suspect, and got some really good, strong evidence. In addition, that case is still going, so there's actually more to come on that case. And that is great because we don't have many shootings here in Temple City, as you all know, so that's a great outcome. We're almost batting 1,000 there. We also had a residential burglary operation. What we like to do is get other teams involved. So in this particular case, we had the county team, the summer team, and our team, and we patrolled the city. So we try to put as many units out in the city as possible. If we can afford to do it, we will put guys in unmarked vehicles, just an average car driving around, it looks like, but it's actually deputies looking for criminal activity or persons who just seem out of place. In this particular case, we sent out a couple of unmarked cars or undercover cars. We issued and a lot of times just it doesn't really, how should I say it, if we arrest people, it doesn't make or break a good operation, in other words. Sometimes we just patrol just to enforce, and it's a great thing if we see nothing that stands out, so I want to say that. In this particular case, we got somebody with a driving with a suspended license, somebody who had a misdemeanor warrant. We just cited them. We take people generally, they can go to jail for a warrant over $26,000. Generally, something under $26,000 would be just a citation in the field. We also identified an individual with an out-of-county burglary warrant. He'll be arrested at a later date and time. There's a little more on that, but I won't get into it. We also conducted a probation operation that included individuals with charges out on probation for controlled substance, possession of marijuana for sales, sex crimes against a child, and altering a firearm. Once again, these are residents who live in the city. We arrested two persons for possession of a controlled substance. It was methamphetamine. We arrested a person for having a narcotics paraphernalia, and another person was issued a warrant. Actually, two people were issued warrants because we found drugs at the residence, and they were not there, so they have warrants outstanding. We also conducted a transient operation. A lot of times we'll patrol the city to try to, you know, deter the panhandling. We want to maintain the quality of life here. We try to direct the homeless to shelters or the proper assistance. We have a unit that actually patrols the county and will come over if someone has some sort of mental disorders. Obviously, we can't get to everyone, but we try to do what we can. And some people just never learn. So in this particular case, two people went to jail for being under the influence of suspected methamphetamine. We did another undercover operation where we looked at a lot of times we'll get calls from residents regarding maybe possible narcotic sales or things of that nature, next door neighbors, people on their residence. A lot of times we'll try to watch those locations and see what we can come up with. In this particular case, we had a resident that was suspected of selling narcotics, and another one that was possibly a massage parlor. The narcotics residents, I'll tell you, if they're selling narcotics, they're going to go poor because we saw no activity there. That's probably about our fifth time we've actually been to that residence, so right now that one's probably on the back burner. We also developed information on a massage residence, but once again, we got some information, but I can't say that anything's really going to happen on that. So far, it seemed pretty dead. Okay, we assisted Rosemead on a operation. That was my team of Deputy Adams, Deputy Cardella, and Deputy Alvarez. Actually made four felony arrests for that city and eight misdemeanor arrests. So my guys really did a great job that day. We also had our community academy, which I discussed last month. We had 14 participants. That includes everything from academy training to a tour of the jail to a homicide lecture, which was very informative, to going to our tactics and survival unit, which was a very big hit. Unfortunately, some of our people that were in there were here, just left. I would have liked to have had them give us a thumbs up or a thumbs down, but everybody really liked it. I have some photos here, but we're not going to see them today. We also had an Area Number 11 watch meeting. You probably know what that is by now, I'm sure. This included, this particular month, we handed out approximately 800 flyers. We did get a very good turnout, but once again, we handed out 800 flyers. We got 80 people in attendance, which you guys know that's pretty great to have 80 people show up anywhere. So it was a very good showing. I'll end with this. Some of the arrests we had for the month that I thought were pretty good here was my team found an individual sleeping on one of our residential streets, and that individual had a lot of marijuana in his possession, a lot of money, and a lot of drug paraphernalia. So that was a very good arrest. We also had an individual arrested for residential burglary. So you in a little more on that in just a second. Park Patrol did a great job. They detained two individuals breaking into a city building. So that was a great arrest. Ms. Zendejas responded to one of our city buildings and did a great job and detained some guys and was able to call us patrol to get there to detain them. We also had this is kind of interesting. We had some individuals at the school that were actually, I believe they were about 13 or 14, goes to show you how, some kids start at an early age. They were actually waiting for their fellow students to exit, I believe it was the locker room area. As soon as the kids did, these three misguided youths, we'll call them, would go into the backpacks and steal these kids' property, phones, little computers, whatever, and they were finally caught. So they're now redirected to our VITA program, and let's hope that works out for them. Let's see here. We had one more that I wanted to talk about that was very interesting, and everybody probably heard the sirens last month. It was an individual, possibly under the influence, or I don't know if he had some sort of emotional or mental problems, but he actually broke into a residence with a family. There was a couple of young ladies, young girls, present. At some point, they initially thought it was a friend of the family's. They realized it wasn't. They called out to their parent, who came downstairs, chased this person out of the house. Person ran out, then ended up seeking or hiding on a balcony where somebody was in their room, happened to see him. This individual busted into the sliding glass door, literally busted the window, entered. A couple of male suspects fought him off. One with a golf club, and they fought him off. That individual ran into another house where a window was open. This is why we don't want to leave our windows open, and where he tried to hide. And I'm sorry, at night, I should say. I mean, obviously, we want to say we're a safe community. Let me back up here. But at some point, we go to sleep, we should lock our doors and windows. That's how I mean it. I know I do, and I'm a police officer. Anyway, at some point, the individual broke in to the house and tried to hide. When the resident ran out and directed the deputies to this individual, he was captured. Once again, I don't know if he had some sort of mental or emotional problems or what his situation was, or he was under the influence, but that's pretty much our month. As you can see, pretty busy, and the guys did a great job in patrol.
Thank you. Sergeant, could you please... just for the audience, explain a little bit about the VITA program.
Yeah, what that is I believe it's a vital, actually, I don't want to guess because I'm going to butcher it, but the bottom line is we have an individual, actually a team, assigned to redirect youths from around the area, not just Temple City, but to try to direct them. These are individuals that have been pointed out by maybe either law enforcement or teachers or members of the community that think that maybe these kids possibly have some sort of problems. You know, it could be they stole something or did something of that nature. And the bottom line is because they're youth, we try to, interject there and get them before it goes bad. And from what I understand, according to Deputy McNicholas, who runs the program, they have a great success rate. A lot of the kids want to do it over again. And from what I hear, it's a great success rate. So.
It actually stands for Vital Intervention and Directional Alternatives.
Okay, I I would have never got that. I had the vital, though.
It's a program that obviously is put together by the Sheriff's Department to basically, I think, take kids who are maybe starting to work, go in the wrong direction, and straighten them out before they get much worse. So we've talked about that program before, I think, at our meetings, monthly meetings as well. So it's a good program. I do have one question. We may hear from our staff a little later on this evening regarding issues having to do with the 4th of July. I just want to know from your perspective, from the sheriff's perspective, how that went and how you, what, if anything, the sheriff was doing that evening to make sure that our city was safe.
Okay, I'm glad you brought it up. Actually, I was going to bring it up next month, so I'm going to talk about it now, but I'm going to definitely talk about it next month.
By that time, it'll be old news, though.
I don't want you to think I'm kind of double billing or making us, you know, look good. That particular night, the team, myself, Deputy Adams, Deputy Cardella, Deputy Alvarez, we went out with Mr. Arizumi over here, who works with the city, and I'm sorry, we hired one more guy. I don't know if you remember Deputy of the Year, Bill Harrington. We paired up in twos, and it was a great success. We issued 17 administrative citations, 20. Brian just corrected me, 20 administrative citations. We confiscated, and once again, I didn't weigh it. I'm only going by lifting a lot of that stuff. I would say at least 100, 150 pounds of illegal fireworks. Wow. And the best part about it was a lot of the people that we issued the citations to, you would think they'd be very angry and hostile, which I'm actually used to. It was kind of shocking, as all I heard was, I said, next year, just so you know, I tried to end on a positive, and they all told me, just about every one of them, there will be no next year for this type of stuff, and we're sorry, very apologetic. A lot of very good people that just, you know, I don't know, use poor judgment, I guess I'll say.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Thank you. Okay. We move to item six, public comments on items not listed on the agenda. If you'd like to address the council, please fill out one of the speaker cards with our city clerk. We have a Jing Lee. And Jing is here regarding library services.
Good evening, Mayor, Council Member. My name is Jing. I'm the Community Library Manager from Tampa City Library. I'm here to talk about our upcoming programs. And today we launched a free service. It's called Zillio Free Magazine. So basically, you can read like a full digital copy of your favorite magazine on a computer, tablet, smartphone, or mobile device. So we have like over 100 titles, include some popular magazines like Rolling Stone and ESPN, O Magazine, US, Food Network Magazine. All this, as long as you have a library card, it's free. And we also have like, if you just go to our website, www.colapublib.org. And you just go to research and learning, and the free magazine subscription is over there. And also on that same page, the research and learning, we offer a lot of stuff. Like you can learn classes like from computer science to home and gardening. It's all free as long as you have a library card. And also upcoming programs at the Temple City Library. This Saturday we have the vegetarian cooking demonstration at 2:00. And then next Saturday at 12, we're gonna have a Chinese traditional dance performance. In August, as the last day of August at 12, we're gonna have a Japanese flower arranging program as well. So we have the flyer available at the library. So if you're interested, just stop by to the library to get your copy. And our summer reading program is still very strong. So if you haven't joined the summer reading program, just you can sign up today. And you read the books, read the review, you get a free prize, which includes some local business, gift cards. Thank you.
Jing, just a quick question. At the Library Commission meeting that I went to last month, the librarian, chief librarian, I'm not
county,
a
county librarian.
County librarian. Uh-huh. Said that there were about 19 libraries, and at the time of the meeting they weren't identified, that were going to receive each about 10 to 12 e-readers, where the public can come in and say, for example, you're a mystery reader.
Yes.
You can check out the e-reader loaded with a preset number of mystery books for up to 3 weeks.
Yes.
Will our library be receiving
this? Well, not, unfortunately, because that funding is come like, I think, part of the supervised money and part of the legal settlement. So their purpose is very specific. So has to meet certain, like, you know, standard. I was very disappointed at the meeting. So I asked her, so that's her answer. And she said... but Zosmi Zosmi is one of the sites. So if Zosmi is not too far from here, if you want to get the e-reader, you can go to Zosmi. And also in the future, hopefully, other supervisors see the benefit of this project. Maybe they're willing to give us more money, so maybe we can become one of the sites.
Well, whatever we can do to help influence that,
okay,
please
I'll
let us
her know.
When you refer to supervisor, are you referring to the board of supervisors or
board of supervisor. Most of the library was selected, I understand, is from like the first district.
Okay.
It's from Supervisor Galina Molina's district. So most of the library. Yeah.
Maybe a topic to bring up with Mr. Antonovich when we meet with him.
We could put that on our agenda.
Yes, perhaps.
For him.
Thank you.
To use this?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have to go to the library to do it?
No. You just go to our website, the website, which is also on the calendar or on your library card. CollabPUBLIB.org is under the research and learning. So if you're interested, I can show you after the meeting, or you can come to the library. I can show you how to do it.
So I could do this from home?
Yeah, you can do this at home.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you check out the library just like you check out books?
Yeah.
Check out the magazines?
Yeah.
And then like 14 days or something like that,
21
days.
I think actually it stays there forever or somehow.
Okay.
But the file is large.
Okay.
So.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay. And I'd like to call Stacy James. And Stacy would like to speak to us regarding police responses to animal attacks.
And the other, there's one more thing on there. That actually means a little more to me, but I think I'm gonna faint. I think we could all agree that we've seen or at least heard of the dog that got shot and killed by the police officer because the animal owner didn't roll up his window. I'm not here to debate the responsibility of whether it was the police or the guy who owned the dog. And I have a great respect for the police. I've needed them a couple of times, and they were there, I mean, within a minute and a half to get a guy that was trying to break into my house. I have great respect. But on the other hand, I've also been the victim of mistaken identity and yanked and thrown onto a car and searched. And I would hate to think that if my dog was in the back of my car and I didn't have a chance to roll up my window and it was a mistaken identity, because I'm a good citizen. I've been here for 46 years. Going on 47. And I would hate to think that based on some kind of urgency on the police's, due to the police, that I didn't get a chance to roll up my window and my dog jumped out, that he would, I hope he doesn't get shot dead. So with a lot of the debates that have gone on through Facebook, I've been challenged to actually speak. I know that you guys aren't responsible for the county. I know we're subsidized by LA. But I also know that we have opportunities to have contracts with them for our specific city. And I was hoping that maybe, you know, I can voice my opinion, put it in the minutes, so that if somebody else sees it and feels as strongly as I do, that maybe we can train our police officers and give them tranquilizers, that they can handle those situations better because I have been on the brunt end of those mistaken identities. Now, that is not to say for a legitimate reason that somebody needs to do that, but that's what I would like to put out there, that if we can give our police officers in Temple City tranquilizers and training on how to better handle a situation like that than having the necessity to shoot a dog dead, I would really, really appreciate it.
Thank you, Stacey. And you said there was another issue.
There is one other issue. A few years ago, and I happen to know this airs on Channel 3 of the local cable channel, and I was watching it, and there was a woman on the panel, and they called up new business. And it was very discerning to me, and I've been upset about it, and I didn't really know that I can come here and do this. Which, thank you, by the way. She said, and I quote, any new business, she says, they announced any new business, and she said, and I'd like to say that Temple City is 60% Chinese, Vietnamese, and any new business needs to appeal to them. And as a resident of Temple City for 46 years, that hurt me to my core. That was very offensive to me.
Stacey, I'm not sure that you heard that where?
On the Channel 3. This thing airs on Channel 3 on the local cable channel.
And that was a resident or someone came up to the...
No, that was one of the panels. One of the city council members. She was an Asian woman. It was a couple of years ago. I'm not sure who she was, but I saw her say that. And I just want to make sure before I spend any more of my money in Temple City that I'm also going to be appealed to as well as a non-Asian American.
Well, I want to thank you for coming. And yes, you do have the opportunity. It's your privilege and your right to come and address the city council whenever you have a concern. So I thank you for that. And I can't speak to anyone else who was here prior to this council, but I can assure you that this council takes all residents into consideration. So thank you very much.
Thank you for that. Thank you.
Mayor, may I just make one quick comment? Our city is not subsidized by LA County, by the way.
Oh, somebody told me that.
No.
Oh, good. Then that makes my question.
We have a contract with the LA County Sheriff's Department, but we pay for the expenses through our general funds.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, good. That makes me a little more hopeful. Thank you for that comment because, you know, I've been told all these different things that, I've been told all these different things, and thank you for that bit of knowledge because at least I know that if other people, when I tell my story here,
right,
that if other people want to come and say something, that maybe my voice can be stronger through groups of concerned citizens as well. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Stacey. Okay. Wilson Truong, and Wilson is here to speak on the Metro 710 study. Welcome.
Good evening, Council. Glad you guys are here today, as I came last week and no one was here. But it's okay. My name is Wilson Truong. I'm here in behalf of Metro. I'm just here to invite the Council and the attendees today, as well as the City of Temple City, to a community meeting that Metro is hosting to discuss the SR 710 North freeway congestion project to relieve traffic along the 710. At the community meeting, Metro is going to discuss the five alternatives that Metro has boiled down from 100 alternatives to reduce traffic along the 710. The alternatives include a bus route system, a train system, a transportation system management system. It's basically widening streets, including bike lanes, synchronizing lighting along where the 710 may end. And also the last and most controversial alternative is an underground freeway tunnel, four lanes each way. Right now, the alternatives are being considered in an environmental study, environmental impact report, EIR, EIS. So I invite the attendees here today, the City Council, to come to these community meetings and voice your opinion, because Metro is, values the community's voice and their thoughts as well in this long study. Thanks. And I have material here with the meeting dates. They're July 20th, 18th, and 23rd in the cities of El Sereno, Pasadena, and then the last one I believe is Monterey Park. So the flyers are all here as well if you guys want some. Any questions?
Yeah, I know our planning commissioner, Cordes, I believe. believe, attends the meetings that you have and brings information back to us.
Perfect. All right. Great. Anything else?
You know, I kind of missed part of what you were saying. What stage is this at?
It is, the alternatives have been considered. Now they're studying the environmental impact that it might have, the five alternatives, and narrowing it down to five, to four, to three, to one. So basically they're boiling it down to as less alternatives as possible based on the environmental impact report, which is going to be released this fall.
This next meeting you're having is to address five
possibilities. Yeah, to inform the public and have the public have feedback on the alternatives.
And then how does it get down to four?
Through the environmental impact report that will be released this fall, I believe it will be even furtherly discussed and narrowed down more and more as the time comes.
Yeah. Do you see any that are out in the lead?
I can't speak for any alternatives in the lead because a lot of people don't like many of the options. Well, there's a no-build option as well. Sorry, I forgot to mention that. There's also a no-build option, but Metro believes that if nothing is done, traffic congestion along the 710 will continue to worsen and harm the cities along the 10 corridor and 710 area. So that's Metro's stand on that.
Are there any residents of South Pass that want this?
Probably former residents of Alhambra, but I don't believe any South Passing. Because I attended the 710 day in Alhambra, and yeah, the opposition is very vocal.
It's pretty strong. South Passing.
Yeah, I know. How many people came out?
Former South Pass resident. I'm supportive of it.
You are supportive of it?
Yeah, it's a former South Pass.
What do you want, the tunnel?
I don't know. Depending on the cost. I want a solution, yes.
Yeah. At the 710 day, it was a success, even though it was 710 day to the audience here. It was a day that Hammer hosted to celebrate the Metro 710 to promote outreach for the event, for the movement. And they closed off the Fremont Street from Valley to the next street over. And I had about 200 guests with children and live band. It was fun. Yeah. So I have flyers here for audience to grab if they like, and for the council as well. And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions?
Probably best to leave the flyers maybe on the back table there.
Forty years ago, my parents built a new home on the border of Alhambra, Los Angeles. It was actually, after only being in the home for about 2 years, we had to sell the property to the state for the freeway. And once in a great while, when I go back to that area, the house is still standing, along with the whole street.
Is that by Cal State?
No, it's actually on the Commonwealth, near Commonwealth and Huntington Drive.
Yeah.
And the home is still there, and there's no freeway. So, anyway, my experience with the freeway. Okay. Is there anyone else who would like to address the council? May we have a motion?
Motion to close public comment.
Wait.
I'm so sorry. Please come on up and
withdraw the motion.
If you can fill one of these out before you leave. Go ahead.
Is that Robert's rules?
Thank you.
I'm also a resident of Temple City.
Speaking of the mic, please.
Or just pull it down. Yeah,
yes.
Pull it down.
Oh, that too.
There you go.
I'm also a resident of Temple City and have been for a long time. Recently, I had an occasion with a friend of mine to come over to Denny's on Rosemead to have a piece of pie, a cup of coffee, and I was taking her home. And when I got into the parking lot, it was pretty bare. There wasn't a lot of traffic, and there weren't a lot of cars parked in the parking lot. And so I decided I'm going to park close to Denny's because it was about 8:30, 9 o'clock, and I figured by the time we came out, it'd be a little bit dark. So I wanted a little safety for my friend and myself. And when I drove into the parking space, ahead of me, the space was empty, as well as the spaces in front of me and in front of the other space. So I said, well, I'll just park straight ahead, and then I don't have to turn around and go out. When I came out with my friend, there was a ticket on my window. And so then I've got it right here. And it states that I had pulled through, not pulled through, that I had backed in. You know, as you come in, you back in. Well, I don't do that. I usually just drive in. And since there wasn't any car parked in front of me or any cars on the side of me, I said, well, why don't I just go right on through? Then I just go right out. So I looked for a sign that said I wasn't supposed to pull through. I had to go down two aisles before I could see a sign that said about not pulling through. So I didn't, I even put it down here on my, so what I said is that I did not back in, I pulled through, but they stayed on the ticket that I backed in.
What was your name again? I'm sorry.
My name is Irene. Irene Ascasio.
Irene, are you aware that we have a public safety commission where you can come and appeal?
No, this is the first time I've gotten a ticket, and I mean, I'm parked.
Do we have... Brian, can you just explain a little bit briefly the... in 2 minutes and 30 seconds, approximately, the process.
Yes, Mayor, I'll briefly explain the process. Once a citation is issued, a person has 21 days to contest or pay the citation. Mm-hmm. To do so, you can either come to City Hall and to our public safety counter and file that appeal, or it can be done so online at www.citationprocessingcenter.com. Once your citation is reviewed at the first stage of review, you do have a second stage of appeal with the hearing officer. In this case, it is our public safety commission. If they uphold that citation during the hearing, you do have a third choice to appeal the citation to a judicial review, and that will be reviewed at the Stanley Mosque Court in downtown LA. So there is a process as set forth by the vehicle code, and if you have further questions, you can come see us tomorrow in City Hall.
I'm aware of the process, because the following day I was down at City Hall, and I spoke to somebody who's also takes care of animal regulation and also public parking, things of that sort. And I have my... I filled out my forms. They're given to me by the city clerk, and then she took me over to the other side. So I'm aware of all that. In fact, I asked for a copy, a photocopy of what was taken, because it says on the citation that they took a photocopy.
Irene, so. Could I ask you just for the matter of time, if you could please speak with Brian, and then, you know, I asked him to hurry up, but that was all without taking a breath. And
I
so
know. I know.
So it actually wasn't Brian's. But if Brian, if you would please speak with Irene, and then he can, slower.
I did not come in here so you can tell me that, because I'm already aware of the process, and I've been waiting patiently, and I've called, and I've spoken to the city clerk people, and they tell me that I'll be receiving something in the mail. I haven't thus far. And this happened in June the 18th.
How long is the process for her to receive something in the mail?
Usually our reviews are done within maybe 3 to 4 weeks. And so if we have a backlog, that if she'd submitted on June 18th, maybe within the next week or two, something should be sent out.
That was June 18th. We're almost getting close to the 18th again.
Yeah, 3 to 4 weeks is what
so
we
So you mean July 18th?
Yeah.
She should receive something.
Within the next week or two.
So... Can I ask you to wait until...
Of course, I've been waiting all this time. I expect I'm going to wait.
That time, and then if you do not hear anything, please contact Brian.
That was my intention, yes.
Okay. And I will say, you are not the first person to come up and speak to the issue of...
No, I don't think I am.
Yes,
either.
Of Rosemead Boulevard, and definitely the Public Safety Commission has looked at that issue, and they can look at signage, so... again, we have a public safety commissioner here, and I think that they can take a closer look at that. So I want to thank you very much for your...
One of the things I wanted to say is, how did they know I pulled through?
I can't answer that for you, but I would definitely follow through, let the process run its course, and at that time, hopefully staff will be able to, direct you through the process if you have any more questions. But the city council, isn't here to decide those issues. But I want to thank you for taking the time. And we can refer it to our public safety commissioner and staff to take a closer look.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Are there any more public comments? Anyone else?
I'll move we close public comments.
Second.
Okay, the motion has been moved and seconded. No objections. It's been carried. We move to our consent calendar, item 7. If members, all consent calendar items may be approved in a single motion as recommended unless removed for further discussion. If members of the City Council or persons in the audience wish to discuss any matters listed on the consent calendar, please address them at this time.
I move that we approve the consent calendar.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Hearing no objections, the motion has been carried. We move to item 9, new business.
Item 8.
Oh, I'm sorry. Everybody said it at the same time.
Item 8. Unfinished.
What would my meeting be without an error?
Somebody else's meeting.
Item 8, unfinished business. Second reading and adoption of ordinance number 13-974, amending Chapter 1, Zoning Code of Title 9 of the Temple City Municipal Code to require a conditional use permit for all signs with changeable copy. And we are going to have a presentation. Jeffrey?
Well, just quickly, staff gave a presentation at the first reading PowerPoint, so we don't have anything to add to that. I'm here to answer any questions and just to mention that since that date, we have still not received any communications from the public regarding this item.
Great. Any questions?
I'll move that we waive further reading and adopt ordinance number 13-974, amending Chapter 1, Zone Code of Title 9, Zoning Regulations of the Temple City Municipal Code to require a conditional use permit for all signs with a changeable copy.
Second.
Okay. I'd like to open the public hearing on this item. Anyone?
Move to close.
Second.
Are there any comments from council? None? I'm ready for a motion.
Okay, I'll restate the motion. I believe it was moved and seconded. I jumped the gun.
Yes, it's okay.
And I'll resecond.
Okay, if no objections, the motion carries. We move to item 9, new business. Redesignation of voting delegate and alternate for the League of California Cities annual conference to be held September 18th through 2013.
Mayor, I'm sorry, I should have broken in earlier. The clerk needs to read the title of ordinance.
Just wave your hand, Peggy.
I thought she had a little buzzer or something over there.
But that would be helpful.
Ordinance number 13-974, an ordinance of the City Council of City of Temple City, amending Title 9 of the Municipal Code to require a conditional use permit for all signs with changeable copy.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. We move to item 9, new business, with all that I had already said. I'm going to ask Mayor Pro Tem Bloom, since he was our delegate, if you'd like to just give a short synopsis of all that reading.
Yeah, the league conference coming up in September, there's some matters that will get voted upon, and the league, our council, as all councils do, have to identify their delegates ahead of time. Two meetings ago, or last meeting, we identified myself as the voting delegate and council member you as the alternative. Since that time, my personal schedule has changed. I'm going to be out of state during that time, so I will not be able to make, and I believe Councilman Hughes got commitments also. So therefore, I believe the three of you are going, so we will just need to designate somebody as our delegate and somebody as the alternate to vote on behalf of the city.
I'd like to make a recommendation to have Councilmember Chavez be our delegate, if he would accept, and Council Member Viscar, our alternate.
Sure, no problem.
Also move.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved.
Since we're not there.
It's seconded. We need to open public comments on this.
Stay till Saturday anyway.
I don't think so.
Yeah. It says.
Yeah.
Yes? Okay. Oh, is there anyone who would like to discuss that issue?
And move we close public hearing.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Are there any comments from our new delegate and alternate?
No.
Gee, I feel honored.
Yeah, I apologize for, I know I'm the delegate to the League of Cities and attend most of their meetings, but it's a family conflict that came up, so I'm sorry about that.
Okay. Okay, can we have a motion?
I move that we delegate Councilmember Chavez as the delegate and Vizcarra as the alternate.
Seconded.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Hearing no objections, the motion is carried.
Just matter of order. On that one, couldn't the mayor just appoint the two people? Do we have to go through a voting process?
The actual League of Cities, I think, requires that it be a reso in the way that we do it. Yes.
Okay.
Good question, though.
Thank you.
We move to item B, public hearing, election of uniform public construction cost accounting procedures by ordinance and resolution. And I'd like to hand this over to our city attorney.
Thank you, Mayor. This is something that my office, Greg Murphy of my office, and your Director of Parks and Recreation, Kathy Burrows, have worked on for some time. Unfortunately, we didn't get this in place before the council wanted to do the construction on the gazebo. But this, what we're proposing tonight would have allowed us to do that in a much simpler manner. If you remember, the gazebo project was to add some concrete in front of the gazebo for an expanded dance floor, and it was a very low dollar value project. Well, even though we're a charter city, we have a provision in our charter that says that we have to comply with the public contracts code. Public contracts code requires the city to bid out any public works project with a value of $5,000 or more. It's incredibly low. And that's a full formal bid. Well, as you know, that's time consuming and it's not very efficient. But there is an alternative. Several years ago, the state passed something called the Uniform Public Construction Cost Accounting Act that provides an alternative to formal bidding. We're recommending that the city adopt that Uniform Public Cost Accounting Act, and you do that in two ways. One, you have to elect to be subject to it. That's the resolution that we have in front of you, Reso 134931, if passed by the council, will be our election to comply with the act, and then we'll send that up to the state and register with them and let them know that we've we're going to comply with it. And you also have to adopt an informal bidding procedure that is consistent with the act. That's ordinance number 13977. Why would we want to do this? Well, the act allows us to have a threshold of $45,000 on public works projects to either do with our own forces or to act as our own general contractor. That essentially means that we can directly negotiate with vendors and have the city manager take care of those contracts when they're at $45,000. Over $45,000 up to $175,000, it allows us to do an informal bidding process. We have to send out a notice inviting bids. We send that either to a list of pre-selected contractors for the type of work that are being done, and or send it to a series of trade journals designated in the public contracts code. Over $175,000, we have to go through a formal bidding process. There are some specific notice requirements that are included in the ordinance adopted. They're not very onerous. There are some other cost accounting procedures that staff will have to follow. For the most part, this will give us latitude on projects between $0 and $175,000 that will allow us to hopefully save time and avoid formal bidding. It will impose some additional requirements on some larger projects. Maybe Kathy or Tracy want to comment on the additional requirements. But all in all, we think it'll be advantageous for the city.
What is the difference between the 45 threshold and the 175 threshold?
Between 45 and 175, you have to do an informal bid process. You can send out a notice inviting people on a pre-selected list of contractors, or you can send it to trade journals that are designated in the public contract.
And who has the authority to select the contractor, and does it have to be low bid?
It does have to be lowest responsible bidder, and it would depend on the amount of the contract. If it's the ordinance provides that it's at 45,000 or so, city manager could do that, but anything over that needs to come back to the city council to award the contract and sign it.
And if it's under 4,500?
Under 45,000, then we can, city manager can negotiate a contract.
Oh, I thought initially you said 4,500.
No, it's $45,000. Okay. That's the primary benefit of small projects.
Thank you. Kathy, any questions?
Yeah, I just wanted some clarification. You said there's a list of qualified contractors maintained by us?
The city will have to develop a list of qualified contractors for various categories of work if it wants to utilize that exception.
And what's the criteria to select to become the qualified contractor?
If they're a licensed contractor with qualifications.
Basically anybody. That, type of work. I mean, how do we make the list?
We've had that
be selected.
Past.
For the Public Arts Commission, we did that for the artists.
Yeah. I'm just curious how to get on that list. I mean, because we're really limiting the, you know, I agree with the concept, but we're really limiting competition here. And
what council member, you don't have to limit it just to your pre-qualification list. You can send it to the people on your list and to the trade journals that are specified.
Uh-huh.
And so anybody who picks up those trade journals is open to bid on it. You're not required to, but if you're worried about competition, the city can do both.
You're going to have to develop some kind of criteria to develop a list.
I would imagine it would be a similar process as our Public Arts Commission did for the artists.
You might choose to look at a list that another jurisdiction has. You might choose to go through a pre-qualification process where you ask contractors to send a statement of qualifications. Typically, when you do that, you have a grading scale where you look at not only the fact that they have a license, but types of projects that they've done, average costs of those projects, you ask for references. There's a lot of ways to do
what
that.
What their specialty is?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess my question is really, does the city then need to go through a RFQ, request for qualification process, we can develop our own ranking criteria, obviously, some certain pass-fail, safety record, and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So this will allow the city to develop its own criteria to maintain a list of selected best qualified contractors.
That's right. And the general idea is that you'll do one list for a variety of different types of work that are recurring, so you don't have to do it each time a project comes up. You have a master list that you use for a number of projects.
And then there's really no particular requirement how long we need to maintain that list, how often we rotate people in and out.
You know, I didn't notice a requirement in the code. Kathy, did you notice something?
You know what, it's the code section, and this is the requirements that we've been looking at. Basically, it says, during November of each year, each public agency which has elected to become subject to the Uniform Public Construction Cost Accounting Procedures shall mail a written notice to all construction trade journals designating for that agency what trades we want to look for, inviting all licensed contractors to submit their name of their firm to the agency for inclusion on our list of qualified bidders. So we have to go through the trade journals, and it's listed in here which, where you're located, what trade journals you have to submit this to. And my understanding is that has to be done once a year, by November of each year. So if we're, we have upcoming projects for road improvements, for instance, we know we're going to have, then we would submit or mail the notice to those that are under that type of license for them to submit a pre-qualification bid.
Okay. And I should say the middle zone is an elective zone. You can always do a formal bid.
Would that apply to non-construction, like IT and
stuff? No, only public works projects.
Okay. I'd like to open the public hearing. No one?
Yeah, she has her hand.
I'm sorry, miss. Could you come to the podium?
And state your name, please.
Helps put you on the record and for the people who might be watching.
Hi, my name is Zen Vong. Do you think that implementing something like this might encourage nepotism for certain contractors?
I would certainly hope not. The idea behind this is to actually have a stricter accounting of costs and a more open bidding procedure.
Thank you. Okay. Anyone else? We have a motion?
Move that we close public hearing.
Can we have a second?
Second.
The motion has been moved and seconded. Hearing no objections, the motion carries. And Attorney Vail, does our city clerk need to read this?
Well, you just had a motion to close the public hearing, so now I think you need to see if any council members have questions, and then you'll have a motion to introduce by title only and waive.
Can I just clarify, because
sure,
it, and this is for my own learning, it seems that when we, numerous times when I opened the, before council comments seem to jump in before we open up the public comment and close the public comment. So should the council members wait until after we close the public comment before they ask questions and start making comments?
It's a good question. And sometimes it gets a little blurry, but the traditional way of handling it is to have a staff report. Then questions from the council members to staff about the staff report and about what's being proposed. After those questions are answered, then to have a public hearing. Then you close the public hearing, and then you come back to debate and discussion among the city council. Now, that might mean a city council member has an additional question because somebody in public comment raised a good issue or they thought of something. But traditionally, it's now time to hear the thoughts and impressions and opinions of the council.
Okay, so it would be the presentation by the city attorney, then questions from the council,
yes,
then open up the public.
Correct.
Hearing. So, Peggy, if we can put that into the notes, that would be helpful. Thank you. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay. So now we are...
Does our council comments?
Is there any council member who has a comment?
Yeah, I have a comment.
Yes.
I did not make any comment. It was just clarification questions that I was asking on the proposal. I must say I'm not familiar with the I'm familiar with the public contract codes, but not this Uniform Public Construction Cost Accounting Procedure. It does seem to have certain advantages and certain disadvantages. I think it's an interesting concept. I think we should give it a try, but yet I'd like to hear back in maybe a year or so how we do. How many firms we have, for example, and what's our perhaps. a staff report on how we've been selecting our contractors and how successful we are in maintaining this list and the sort of results that we've been getting with the bid, with this informal, quote-unquote informal bid.
Would you like to ask Brian at a future council member to go over the procedures that they did, because basically those artists are going to be contractors at some point also. And
those won't be public works contracts.
Okay, yeah. So it's just correct. Public works
yeah. Roads, correct. Correct. Springs, that's why I asked the question. Storm drains, okay. Sewers, things like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know what? I think you raise a really good point. And if we don't somehow codify that, we'll forget about it in a year. Everything else will overtake us. And I think there does have to be a procedure in place. And I don't know what kind of a procedure, if it would become part of this motion, or if we should have something that says we need to review our list of contractors every year and be sure that it's updated.
Well, I think, you know, Kathy was mentioning that we're bound already to come back in November of every year if the council adopts this ordinance, then we're bound by that. So you would have an opportunity to do that as well, and as well as through the budget process.
Yeah, I think, council member, you raises a good question, too. We haven't done this before here, and it does give us some nice flexibility on the lower end of project values. But frankly, there are some other requirements that staff's going to have to deal with, and you probably do need to report at the end of the year whether it's being beneficial to you.
Well, wouldn't staff necessarily bring that to attention if they're having a problem?
Yeah, through the staff report.
They would. Yeah. So they're going to self-police that. So I don't see why that would be a problem. Mm-hmm. They'll bring it to Jose's and he brings it back to us. Right. Not brain surgery here.
Actually, from the staff report, it seems like it's the best practice that cities are using.
A number of cities do use it, but not every city is the same. Not every city has the same kind of staff to take care of a lot of governmental hoops. And
we have better staff.
Got great staff. You just don't have many staff. Council, it really depends on how many small value contracts you're going to have. If you have a lot of small value contracts, this is great. If you have no or one small value contract, it's not that helpful.
We have a lot, don't we, Kathy?
I just want to add that low bid is a horrible process, even though it's just, detailed out in the public contract code. Both council member Viscar and I had deal with, your prior experience with county and myself, currently we deal with low bid and suffer through that. It's a very contentious process. It's really not a very good process. But this seems to allow the city to be able to select a qualified panel of contractors. So I think the concept is very good, mm-hmm. that we weed out all the bad ones. And even though it's a low bid, but it's a low bid amount of qualified contractors. So I personally like the idea, but just would like to see a reporting back at certain time in the future after we've gone through the first selection, after we've first developed the criteria, and then first done our selection of our qualified panel, and see how that works out. I think the concept is actually good because it eliminates the lowest of the lowest bottom feeder type contractor.
The setups.
Yeah.
One guy sets up another guy.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not particularly worried about the comment that, certain individual will, get rewarded just because they're friends. Yeah, as long as we have some sort of procedure that that we can distinguish certain selection criteria established. Yeah.
Okay. Any other council member?
Mayor, before you introduce the ordinance, you do have to adopt a resolution first. So this is unusual that you have a resolution and an ordinance you're adopting. So your first order should be to adopt the resolution, and then you would have the city clerk read the title of the ordinance.
Well, we haven't had a motion yet.
No, I understand.
Oh, okay.
I would make a motion that we adopt resolution number 13-4931, electing to become subject to the Uniform Public Construction Cost Accounting Act.
Second.
Okay, the motion has been moved and seconded. Hearing no objection, the motion carries. So now, Kathy, we're going to introduce the ordinance.
And have the city clerk read the title.
And have the city clerk?
Well, first you have to have a motion
to
introduce
it
and read by title only and wait for the reading.
Can we have that motion?
I'll move that we introduce and see, we already held the public hearing.
You already held the public hearing.
ordinance number 13-977 for first reading by title only, adding chapter 11 to title 2 of the Temple City Municipal Code, identifying for the bidding process for public works projects to comply with the act.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Hearing no objection, the motion carries.
Mayor,
I need to read. And now our city clerk will read.
Ordinance number 13-977, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Temple City, adding Chapter 11 to Title 2 of the Temple City Municipal Code to comply with the Uniform Public Construction Cost Accounting Act.
I'm sorry, did you also include in your motion to schedule the second reading?
No, I'll now make a motion to waive further reading of Ordinance 13-977 and schedule the second reading
that was part of, it.
Of the ordinance for August 6, 2013.
I'm sorry, before we say, do we need to add like the staff report back, or would that be sort of an automatic thing?
Well, I have noticed that the city manager has been taking copious notes. I'm sure he put that down as to report back.
Wouldn't that change the ordinance if we did that?
No, that doesn't.
And we'd have to come
I'll
back.
Put it in my notes to make sure we bring it back in a year.
Yeah. After we've done that first selections.
I second the motion.
Do you have a tickle file for stuff like that?
Our city clerk.
Okay.
She keeps track of all this.
Bullpen
stuff.
Items
she's
in
obsessive
the upcoming
and compulsive
council
that way.
So she'll know in a year that...
Yes, she has it in her calendar.
All right.
Okay.
I'll bet you almost none of that made any sense to the audience.
Now we are on item C, public hearing, introduction, and first reading of ordinance number 13-975, amending chapter 1 of title 9 of the Temple City Municipal Code to establish regulations and conditional use permit requirement for tobacco shops, e-cigarette vaporizer stores, and closely related businesses. And we're going to hand this off to our community development director. Oops. Or
thank
not.
You. Yeah. thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the council. Ms. Liu here will give a PowerPoint presentation, then we're both available to answer questions after.
Good evening, Honorable City Council, City Manager, and audience. The reason we're doing this code amendment is because in the past few months, the city had received a large number of inquiries about opening a tobacco shop or a e-cigarette retail business. Tobacco shop is currently permitted almost across the board. In the city, with only exception in the Gateway Commercial, and the staff has a map attached to the staff report, which also permit a tobacco shop, but only requires a conditional use permit. The zoning code also is silent about mentioning e-cigarettes and related businesses. As a result, after the zoning clearance, three business license applications was approved, and three business were established later. However, staff is concerned about the potential of a concentration of this type of businesses. Staff also feels that public health and safety concerns are not addressed in the process of the land use entitlement process. In addition, public input cannot be included into the decision-making process. Of course, this code amendment is also to address the concerns coming from the community. So what exactly an electronic cigarette is? We have an illustration here. It actually consists of three components, beginning with a cartridge containing nicotine solution, followed by an atomizer to vaporize the solution, and empowered by a battery, on which there is a LED light on the other end to mimic the glow of a traditional cigarette.
Does it also produce smoke? In other words, do they inhale and then smoke comes out like a regular cigarette?
If someone exhales, there will be a vapor, like a mist coming out.
The reason I ask is this morning I was out for my bike ride. It was 6 o'clock in the morning. Young lady comes up on the side of me. She's smoking what doesn't look like a cigarette, but some type of cylinder. But yet I see smoke coming out of the out of her mouth periodically. The first thing I wonder is, why is she riding a bike smoking? Seems sure to be kind of contrary to the whole idea. But it looked like what I thought would be an electronic cigarette. I've never seen one in action. But I just, there was definitely smoke emitting from her, So I don't know. Does that?
I can tell you, it looks a lot like smoke if it's an e-cigarette, but it's actually a vapor, okay, water-based type. Because
it did look like smoke.
Yeah. I have a further question when you.
Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, it. Yeah, because you see a lot of commercials. Oh, just vapor, or just, you know, we take our life back in control, that sort of a thing. But I often wonder, you know, you inhale this nicotine, what do you exhale? Do you exhale nicotine as well? Because I can't imagine the lung will absorb it 100%.
Yeah, according to some description, you can exhale the mist of the vapor, which contains a toxic chemical.
Thank you.
Welcome. So let's take a look at what happened at the state and federal level. California prohibits the sale of e-cigarettes to minors. In 2009, U.S. Food and Drug Administration made the decision to regulate plan to regulate e-cigarettes as the same manner that it regulates a tobacco product. A U.S. Department of Transportation and the U.S. Air Force restrict the smoking e-cigarettes on an airplane or by the Air Force. The goal of this proposed code amendment is to provide needed land use regulations for and restrictions for tobacco and e-cigarettes products. And this code amendment will enhance the consistency of the zoning code with the City Council's bigger goals of protecting public safety and health, as well as enhancing quality of life. This move will be consistent with the initiatives that happened at state and federal level. Of course, it is also intent primarily to address public concerns. So what's being proposed? The code is amendment is proposing to require a conditional use permit for any new type of tobacco or e-cigarettes business, retail business, to be located in town. And the business will be required 1,000 feet separations from any public or private school, from any public parks, and from daycare centers, as well as between themselves. And the code amendment is very clear about prohibiting hookah lounge or smoke lounge. There will be visibility requirement requiring the business to provide reasonable visibility for the in-store activities to the pedestrian and vehicular traffic on the adjacent streets. It is also restrict the business to no more than 10% for its window sign. There are also provisions restricting the sale, storage, and the display of paraphernalia. There are 20, the code limits the such activities to no more than 20% of the total floor area. and to be conducted in an enclosed room.
Does the code, I was looking through it, does it specifically identify or define the what is meant by paraphernalia? You could direct me to that real quick. I don't know. I didn't see it anywhere.
Yes.
Or is there somewhere that...
There's an existing definition that's been in the code since about 1960.
Okay.
And so in it, in talking with the city attorney's office, that definition still applies and still works for today's paraphernalia.
Can you give me an example of what that would be? What is paraphernalia? Oh, here we go. I found it.
Okay.
Any apparatus, equipment, or instruments used for smoking tobacco or controlled substance or inhaling mist of nicotine-enriched solutions for the purpose of personal or recreational satisfactions. Okay. There we go. Found it. Thank you. And those are the things that have to be kept behind closed doors.
So staff is requesting City Council to introduce Ordinance Number 13-975 for first reading by title only, wait for the reading, and schedule the second reading of the ordinance for August the 6th, 2013. And with this, we're ready to answer questions.
I have one more question. I understand certain cities actually have moratorium on the sale of e-cigarettes, and I think the recent Pasadena Star News article was that City of Duarte had an emergency moratorium. I believe City of Pico Rivera also has one. I think the Pico one was the total ban of e-cigarettes because the potential use of illegal drugs in it. I don't know how important, how valid some of these claims are. But this ordinance before us would permit the sale of e-cigarettes, except that we're regulating how often they can be located, right?
Yeah, correct. In staff's perspective, we didn't want to start off with an outright ban because they are legal products, and so we wanted to look at ways of regulating them and ensuring that we didn't have an over-concentration of these type of stores in Temple City.
Okay. Thank you.
And I do want to add, we have received recently numerous complaints with the tobacco shops and the e-cigarette stores. In addition, we received a call today from the school district superintendent, and they've received complaints as well. So,
well, it's specifically aimed at one place, isn't it?
Well, we've, as city staff, we've actually received complaints on numerous ones.
Oh.
I guess most of them tend to be geared towards one particular, but we have seen them on three of the five.
Just a comment for really the public. This ordinance doesn't permit the smoking of e-cigarettes or the purchase or sale of e-cigarettes. They're already permitted without restriction in the city. So what this does is add restrictions to the existing sale or use of those, where they can be sold, where those stores can be located. So it's we're trying to reduce the pie, not create it, make it enlarged.
And this ordinance, obviously, or I shouldn't say obviously, but will not have an effect on those businesses that are already in place, correct?
Correct. Our general thinking right now is yes, but I don't want to say that conclusively because we haven't had the right test case to be able to look at the exact facts. I wouldn't want to leave by saying no, absolutely never, the city won't try to enforce this. Our current thinking is that no, it's not enforceable, but that could change.
It's not enforceable. In other words, we cannot go back, let's say two cigarette stores are next to, or two stores selling cigarettes are next to each other within 1,000 feet. That the current thinking is that we probably would not go back and say that one of you need to quit selling.
Correct. Generally, the law doesn't allow you to take an established use that was permitted by law when it was established, change its legality and then force it to end that day. Usually we have to have an amateurization provision. This is most common with billboards and large signs where they're given a certain period of time to recoup their investment, and then they have to cease. There is no amateurization provision in this ordinance. I wouldn't foreclose that in the future, but it's not something that we've put in here. The law does allow certain health and safety regulations and licensing requirements to be imposed. You'll remember that a couple years ago, the city adopted a tobacco retailer permit ordinance. That is something that could be enforced on existing retailers because it's a licensing requirement. It doesn't stop them from doing what they're doing. It just imposes some regulations. There are certain aspects of this ordinance that clearly we would have a problem enforcing. But all of the aspects, there are some condition operating conditions. And at some point in time, the city may come back and say, maybe some of these should apply because they're just health and safety based. We're not at that point today, but I don't want to close that door forever.
Eric, I know currently the FDA doesn't classify the e-cigarettes as a regular normal cigarette, a tobacco cigarette, but they are looking into reclassifying them as a tobacco cigarette.
I think they already do. In our staff report, it appears that the FDA has already, in 2009, they plan to regulate e-cigarettes as tobacco products under the Tobacco Controls Act.
But I don't think they classify it as the same for restrictions of sale. Is that correct?
Yeah, state of California prohibits e-cigarettes to be sold to minors.
Yeah, well, the state has different rules, federal government. The FDA announced their intention in 2009. It takes several years for all their comment periods and rulemaking for things to go into effect. I'm not sure that everything is in effect yet. The state of California, though, does regulate them and prohibits the sales to minors. There's also a bill, I believe, in the state Senate right now that would treat them as just as cigarettes are treated in the state.
So at that point then, could those restrictions be made sooner than later, or do you still have to follow that process you were speaking to?
Well, the regulations in the ordinance that are most difficult for us to impose are obviously the locational requirements. There are requirements about concerning where things are located and how they're presented in the ordinance. That might be something we could look at enforcing. Today, as I sit here, I'm uncomfortable about that. I don't know that we have any bans on the type of products, e-cigarettes or tobacco products, nor are we requiring any particular health warnings. That's really the purview of the state and federal government. So I don't know that if the FDA does anything short of banning them that we'll have anything else in the ordinance that we'll seek to impose on them unless the council decides it wants to try a complete ban on the sale, as Councilmember, you mentioned some other cities have done.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions?
I have a couple of questions. I'm reading a staff report, and maybe someone can clarify this for me. Just before the conclusion in the report, it says that the paragraph before that, the proposed amendment will, one, prohibit such businesses within 1,000 feet of public parks, schools, day centers, and any existing tobacco. So that means that, I think I've answered my own question now, rereading it. So you can't have them each other within 1,000 feet.
Correct.
Now, where did that 1,000 feet come from? How does that figure arrived at?
In looking at other cities and the way cities in general treat either these type of businesses, adult business, other businesses where there's concern how it affects public safety and minors, That 1,000 feet is a general number that is used quite broadly, and so we felt comfortable in using that number.
How many standard blocks would that be, pretty much? Two, three blocks?
Yeah, probably about three blocks, depending on the...
Two, three?
Yeah, depending on...
Well, obviously, yeah, outside, but I mean, a standard block.
Yeah.
700 feet, 720 per block, yeah. Standard.
Do we have a business now within a... It's within... 1,000 feet of
across
that.
The street, yeah. From our park.
Across the street.
And City Hall.
Oh, that's right. This one on the corner.
And then the two farther down on.
What about the one on Rosemead? There's one on Rosemead.
No, it is actually
Rosemead and Longdon.
Our rough calculation. It's actually about 1,500 feet from three different schools.
Okay.
So it actually meets the 1,000 foot.
What? I don't know how far down the liquor store is. You know, they sell cigarettes. If that were within 1,000 feet, would that be a problem?
No, because their primary business is the liquor store. This is only to standalone smoke shops.
Councilmember Scar raises a good point. That was one of the questions we asked. This, my understanding, this applies just to standalone tobacco businesses, not
correct.
To convenience stores, liquor stores, things like that. Who could they sell these products, or do they have the right to sell these products?
Yes, they do, and they could sell them.
And they
but
do
that,
sell them.
Yeah, and some do already. But it is not their primary business.
Oh.
So it's incidental and accessory to the primary use of, you know, a gas station or a convenience market.
That gets into a different issue, and that is the regulation of the use itself rather than the regulation of establishing new businesses, which we're looking at tonight.
Correct.
That's right.
Okay, I just want to clarify what you just said. So that this only applies to shops that the primary function is sell tobacco and e-vapor, vapor shops, or whatever they call now, vapo shop or vape shop, I don't know.
Or e-cigarette.
E-cigarette shops. So, I mean, you could have a whole series of shops selling cigarette incidentally, but yet located right next door to a school, for example. This does not prevent that from happening, right?
Correct.
Well, I think we do have ordinances on the books already that prohibit liquor stores and such to be within certain boundaries of schools, I think, don't we?
I know we have restrictions on liquor stores, but I'd have to refer that back to the planning department. I don't know if we have a locational requirement.
I'm blanking on it as well.
Well, we can always look.
How about like 7-Elevens? You know, the multi-use stuff.
Well, that qualifies as a convenience store, so they could sell them.
But they have cigarettes and booze.
Right.
Yes.
So if the council wanted to make the sale of these e-cigarettes more prohibitive, it would have to be brought back at a different time under an agenda.
Yes, and my office would recommend that you do that by a separate ordinance different from this regulatory ordinance, right, for the sake of avoiding challenges.
Okay.
And I think that would address some of the emails, and I asked that question for a few of the principals that sent us emails, and our superintendent also, about looking at making this more restrictive this evening, and that's not what we're here to do.
Yeah, I think I agree, because I think there's still a lot of research that needs to take place, and a lot of the municipalities are putting in a temporary moratorium to give staff time to research into these e-cigarettes.
That argument's for another day, I believe.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing on this. Is there anyone who would like to address the council? Mary?
You better tell her that you called Mary.
Mary, did you fill out a... Okay, thank you.
Mary Kokeko, Temple City resident. I wasn't at the Planning Commission meeting, but Jim told me, you know, that they passed this, which I was surprised because nobody really knew anything about this. I think they should have held it over. When he told me, I thought, oh, that's good. We're going to get some sales tax. But since then, I have changed my mind. The LA Times ran a great article about this, which I don't think the Planning Commission even really knew what was going on. Councilman Vincent, I read that DeWardy is having a lot. They're getting so many applications that they put a moratorium on. They already have some. What worries me, if we don't put a moratorium, you know what's going to happen? Everybody's going to come here so they can do whatever they want with those. I think you need a moratorium to really figure this out. And also, the paper has, the LA Times said LA is having a lot of problems. They're springing in every place. San Gabriel, it's not just what I'm afraid of. Once one business comes in to Temple City, it's like a parade of them. We had one tea house. Now we have so many tea houses, hairdressers. I'm afraid this is going to happen. I went by that place that opened near across from City Hall. And from what I read, it's like a bar. They have couches there. I looked in. I didn't go inside. Nicotine, if you're going to be sitting there and inhaling this nicotine, what is going to do to you? And it does. The Times had a thing. It's like a smoke coming out. There's chemicals in there, too. And that it's not getting into your lungs, I don't believe that, because I know you probably all know, too, if a doctor gives you a prescription for any kind of ointment to put, it gets into your system. And he tells you, it travels into whatever that is. You're not taking it internally. Even like the dentist gave me something in because I had trouble with my gums. Well, it's not just your mouth is doing it. It's also going into your bloodstream and everything. So I don't think this is really what they're trying to make it out to be. And as far as you can't smoke, you might as well have a cigarette instead of blowing this stuff. And from what I read in the paper, anybody can sell it. It doesn't make any difference. So it's not just the smoke places that they want to open up. Anybody can get this. And you already see people smoke. That stuff's coming out. It's got chemicals. To me, it's probably worse than a cigarette because you don't blow that much out. And it, like Chavez said, he was wondering what this stuff was coming out. It's the chemical, too. And do you think it's not getting to that person's lungs? There's no way it's not getting into their lungs. But I think at this point, you need a moratorium so you can really figure out what we want to do. A lot of cities are starting to put, they're springing up too much. I just want you to stop and think before you do anything.
Thank you. We have your name, please.
Sure. It's Anna Adame, and I did email my response or my.
Would you speak into the microphone, please?
Sure.
I can't hear you.
I emailed all of the council members, but I'm going to go ahead and read what I emailed to you. I understand that this is. That you're considering this code, but anyway, good evening, Mayor Pro, and council member, city council members. First of all, I'd like to commend the Planning Commission staff for being proactive and submitting this proposed ordinance amendment to council. As a resident and a concerned parent, I'd like to see the ordinance be much more restrictive than proposed or even aim to have no smoke shops in Temple City or possibly maybe even a moratorium as it was mentioned. Annually, our PTA, Emperor PTA, hosts Red Ribbon Week activities for our students with a focus on the dangers of tobacco use. With cigarettes being considered considered as the most popular, addictive, and popular form of tobacco use, drugs and alcohol, of course, also. With this being said, I'm especially concerned about businesses like OG Smoke Shop that's located at Rosemead and Longdon, located about a quarter of a mile, 1,300 square feet from Emperor Oak, Longdon, Temple City High, and about 600 feet from TECC Learning Center for Children, located behind Valley Mart. Typically this type of business brings individuals into our neighborhood that may undermine the family values of our community and our children's welfare. Neighborhood watch groups will need to be extra vigilant for all the kind of havoc that could be caused with that type of client. According to the American Lung Association in California, studies have shown that the density of tobacco retailers, particularly in neighborhoods surrounding schools, has been associated with increased smoking rates, and that one-third of illegal tobacco sales take place within 1,000 feet of schools. So therefore, I ask that we work diligently in Temple City to promote healthy lifestyles and support our award-winning schools by restricting smoke shops. I am requesting you consider a tobacco-free zone for our children and further request no grandfathering in of the smoke shops. In particular, what I feel is so bothersome, and I experienced it today, is that I saw three high school, maybe teenage boys walking from the Little Caesars Pizza, walking towards the donut shop and stopping at that storefront, looking into that power wall of paraphernalia, two long shelving units full of marijuana-type paraphernalia. And that's disturbing because it's curiosity, and they are minors, and it's something that is very disturbing for the kids in our community. So that's why I bring it up. I am glad that we're putting restrictions, ordinances in place, but I'd like to see them be more restrictive, even address a larger area or in square footage from the schools, and in downsizing that square footage as to what kind of paraphernalia they can display. That's what other cities have done also. Minimize the percentage. Also, another thing that I did see is that if they have a violation of selling to minors, if they are caught, that they may be removed as a business, from the current business license or something of that sort. That's what other cities are also putting that type of restriction.
Okay, I'd like to thank you for coming, and I think our staff has been proactive, and I think as Councilmember Vizcarra Chavez said, that it's definitely a discussion for another day. Okay. Is there anyone else?
Yes. Good evening, all the city councilmen and the audience. My name is Ray Shaw. I'm pretty glad over here tonight. Actually, I was invited by the other schools. And actually, I am the one at that area, Rosemead and Longdon, over 20 years. So I'm kind of every day, Monday through Friday, I'm watching all the students. They walk from Oak, from Temple City High. They either walk from Emperor Avenue and make a left turn going south toward the Rosemead Boulevard, or either they just directly walk through Oak and then turn right on London. And because the Rose Donut Shop and Little Caesars and the 7-Eleven will be the three most popular shops they would like to stay. So many students, they just hang out over there and talk, buy sandwich, eat ice cream, and buy drink. Lots of students just stop over there. So it's kind of day by day, so for so many years. So I think as a parent, as teacher, or as you know, all the principals, they will be appreciate if there has a very good environment for the student. Even they shop around, they stay over there, buy something, but parents, they don't need to worry about because they just buy drink. But if there are any other kind of, store, just have something easy to give the students the bad influence, I think many people, they will worry about that. And also, we think about like 1,000, the distance, the feet distance. Sometimes it's kind of just a number. But if we say, if we know the pattern for the kids, you will know the difference. Because all the kids, the pattern is they go to that direction. So it means that location will have more, more students. And definitely they will have more influence for them. If we say at the other side, even maybe like just exactly 1,000, but students, they don't walk that way. For example, if it's north, basically we do not have so many students walk toward the north, but we have a lot of students, they walk toward the south. So it makes a big difference. So if we can do some certain kind of limitation, restriction to eliminate or prevent the future problem, I think that's, we are great when we are smart. So that's why we are here tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
Can I?
Yes.
Yeah, it's an interesting point because I'm familiar with Dr. Ray's school, and it's a learning center, right? That doesn't qualify as a school?
Yes, it does.
It does?
Well, she's like within 500 feet.
Yeah, that business was approved prior to this. To this restriction being proposed,
not retroactive to business.
And my first statement was just quick math when it went in, and knowing where the public schools were. So that's where it was with about, it's about 1,500 feet from the three or four public schools.
And I think if I could ask our city attorney, if you wouldn't mind, just explaining that the city based the opening of those stores on what we currently had as far as their legal rights to open a business in Temple City.
Well, prior to this proposed ordinance, the city didn't have any regulations with regard to hookah shops, hookah stores, cigarette stores, e-cigarettes. They could locate pretty broadly in the commercial zones. They did have to get a business license. We have had on the books since the end of 2012 the tobacco retailer ordinance. I'm not sure to the extent that the city's been able to implement that yet, but that doesn't stop businesses from going in any particular location. It just essentially requires them to comply with existing law and not have self-serve type facilities. And I'm not aware that any of the facilities that are in town now have self-serve facilities. And self-serve facilities are things that the public can go in and just reach and grab the product themselves. Or have, if you might remember growing up, there used to be a cigarette vending machine almost in every diner or anything you went to. That's a self-serve machine. I think those have been done away with, too. This will give us some authority to stop businesses from going in certain locations. And so it should be a tremendous tool. If the council feels that a moratorium on further
tobacco-related use is appropriate, you can always consider that. That's not what we're proposing at this time, but that's certainly something you can discuss and do.
Thank you.
And Madam Mayor, if I may add, with the ones that have gone in recently, they were in the process of getting their business license for about a month. It took numerous inspections by staff, and we forced them to rearrange their floor plans to make sure that they met, even though we had minimal requirements, that they met every single one of those requirements. The one that seems to be the most scrutinized OG smoke shop on Rosemead and Longdon, the owner has been aware from day one that he is being watched. We have community preservation officers. Planning staff has asked them if they're anywhere in the area they drive by. We have our senior community preservation officer that drives by there at least twice a week, even if he's not in the area. We've also asked the sheriff's department to keep an eye out, and if they notice any increase in calls for service in that area that we want to know. And all this is because there is a process to revoke a business license that would have to come before the city council. It is a pretty high standard. And so we want to be sure if a particular business, and that one in particular, is causing problems and creating public health or safety issues for the community, that we have that record built up and at a point with the advice of the city attorney, we would bring that back for a revocation.
For example, if we was determined there were a lot of minors hanging out there and visiting that store or coming by there and looking in, that would be something that we could take a look
at. Yeah, it's tougher if they're just looking in, but there is a big sign on the door that says no one under 18 is permitted. And so, and the reason we are constantly out there looking, if we see minors out there, in the store, that's something that we need to know. And I would guess it's probably pretty good grounds to revoke the business license.
And I would suggest that possibly our school ad hoc committee with the school district speak to them about educating the kids about the e-cigarettes, and that there is nicotine, which comes from the tobacco plant. So I think it's something that they already have education and process on tobacco and alcohol, and I think the e-cigarettes are somewhat of a novelty right now. It's very popular, even though it's been around since 2007. I have never seen it up until we had the grand opening here in Temple City that I attended, and didn't know anything about them prior to that. So maybe that's something that you could suggest to them.
Yeah, I agree. And I think you bring up a good point, and something I just wanted to touch on, that, the city obviously is looked at to pass ordinances and make rules and laws to protect the community. And we do, I think, we are proactive in that regard, and especially in this area, evidenced by the fact that we've passed already two ordinances having to do with smoking and regulation. So obviously we know that what those issues are. But at the same time, and there's always, I think about this as a city councilman, is that, we can only do so much. We need help from parents, from teachers, from administrators, everyone that, needs to be a part of this. And yes, we could pass all the laws we want, but at the same token, it has to come from others as well, and those that these children and these minors respect and will listen to, because many of them obviously don't come to our meetings. They don't necessarily know the ordinances that are passed, and a lot of that needs to fall, I think, on parents. And by any means, I'm not saying that we're trying to pass that on, but it has to be a joint effort, and I think what we do here in the city, then combining that with the knowledge that the parents and the public have, I think it'll go a long ways to maintaining the health and safety of our community.
So. Is there anyone else in the public who would like to speak? Can we have a motion?
Move to close public hearing.
Second.
Okay, it's moved and seconded. Hearing no objections. We close public hearing. council comments? Is there any council member who would like further discussion or?
Well, I'd like to comment staff for being proactive and seeing that the trend, and I totally concur with Council Member Chavez's note that, you know, we try to protect the public, but not at all times we can be ahead of the curve. I think the ordinance in front of us is good. It does help in offering certain protections to the public. So I am in support of the ordinance, but I also would like to see with all the interest from county supervisor, for example, from other cities, they're in similar situation that they, a lot of folks have concerns over the e-cigarettes. I mean, I'm less concerned about the regular cigarettes because we know what it is, but the there seems to be a lot of interest in the potential issue of these e-cigarettes. So I like the staff to look into, ask the mayor to ask city to put this back on the agenda and ask staff to bring back a report on that, to give us the staff a little bit more time to research into why certain cities would go so far to totally ban that in their cities.
I'd be happy to do so, and maybe we can, is a couple of months, 60 days, a good time frame? Sooner if you can, yeah. But that gives you something to work with.
Is a total ban actually doable?
You know, Council Member, you've asked me a question I can't answer because I haven't seen any of the bans from the other cities, so I don't know if they're banning the location of the use or if they're actually banning the sale, which is a difficult thing to do.
You know, I kind of think this goes along the issues that we had with the marijuana dispensaries, and I think this is a new issue that's now come up, and my belief is that we'll probably see the same thing happen, and it'll work its way through the legal system, perhaps. At some point, these cities who start passing moratoriums and bans, as they did with the marijuana dispensaries, saw legal challenges which had to be addressed in the courts, and I can see the same thing happening here at some point.
Yeah, these are particularly difficult because in the case of marijuana, it can only be sold by a collective in a certain set of circumstances. Right. It's not like your grocery store or pharmacy could sell medical marijuana. Whereas
it's a larger issue now.
E-cigarettes can be sold by any place. So if you're going to ban the location of new places that sell cigarettes, I'm pretty sure you could do that. If you're going to ban the sale of e-cigarettes in the city, that's a different issue. We'd certainly want to investigate a little further about what those are and what the health risks are.
And in the cities that staff has noticed where they've done moratoriums, it was it's a temporary measure that allows staff the time to create the regulation similar to what we've already done.
Same thing we did with the marijuana. We passed Correct. A moratorium.
And we haven't noticed that any city has actually banned the sale permanently.
I agree with Councilmember Yu. I think this is a step in the right direction. I think it's a necessary step. The bigger issue, of course, is as we mentioned, the ban or use of those products. That's for an argument another day, but I think this is consistent with what we have been doing, and that is to look at items and to deal with public health and safety, and I'm satisfied that the restrictions here, I think, will go a long ways to doing that, gives us some ammunition for dealing with these businesses in the future. So I recommend that we adopt it.
Okay, I have several thoughts. One, I agree that we need to put something in place, and I guess I'll ask a question. You know, we picked the 1,000 feet, sort of a arbitrary number. You know, what would be the consequences if we put that at 1,500 feet or 2,000 feet?
I mean, at a certain point, the farther you restrict it, the fewer sites you have, and at a certain point, you have no sites in the city,
right.
And so from a regulation standpoint for staff, it's easier to just prohibit them. I don't know. We haven't done the research as to what 1,500 and 2,000, how many sites would be left. But, you know, considering the city's only about 4 square miles anyway, the farther you go, the more restrictive it will be. But, I mean, it's to the discretion of council how far they want to go.
I may just add something. Because I'm an occasional user of zoning codes in other cities as well, and so every now and then, you know, the topic of adult entertainment would come up. 1,000 feet seems to be a very common number used in the zoning codes to prohibit certain businesses or adult entertainment, say, next to a school or a church or something. That's not an uncommon number.
The reason that 300 feet, 500 feet, 600 feet, 1,000 feet are typically used is because as you get farther than that, you do just what Jeff mentioned. You start eliminating spaces. And using your example of the adult businesses, courts have ruled that you can't do that. You can put a temporary moratorium in place while you're thinking about it, but if you're permanently going to put a distance requirement that practically doesn't allow anything to happen, that's much more difficult to sustain, and the courts don't give that the same degree of deference.
Yeah, yeah. But First Amendment versus health, public health.
Well, the courts are smart enough to realize that you're really regulating through the back door. You're basically, you know, you could say nothing within 5,000 feet, that eliminates the whole city then. Right. So you really, what you effectively banned it by, you know, something like that.
Okay, just continuing my thoughts, you know, it appears with the popularity of these things popping up so fast that somebody sees an end run around something else that's going on, that they see this as their nose under the tent, or so to speak, to get started with something. And I think Councilman Chavez asked earlier about paraphernalia and, you know, this attracting the customers that then allows something else to happen, and then pretty soon we're on the defensive, and we've got to be fending it off. And so I'm very leery. So I guess I'm supportive of the ordinance to give staff, you know, some ability to deal with this to start with, but I'm also supportive of coming back with further reports on, you know, how do we address this issue. I just, you know, for shops to start popping up as fast as they are, something else is going on other than, oh, this is just a nice new product here. So
there you go. It's a conspiracy theory again. Here we go, huh? There's always some ulterior motive behind the business.
Anything else?
That's it.
Okay. I think we're ready for a motion.
I would make a motion that we introduce and hold a public hearing regarding ordinance number 13975 for first reading by title only, amending Article T, special uses of Chapter 1 Zoning Code of Title 9 Zoning Regulations of the Temple City Municipal Code to establish regulations and conditional use permits requirements for tobacco shops, e-cigarette vaporizer shops, and closely related businesses. And that we further waive further reading of ordinance number 13975 and schedule the second reading of ordinance number 13975 for August 6, 2013.
And the public hearing has already been held.
Second.
Okay. If no objections, the motion is carried.
Mayor.
And
ordinance number 13-975, an ordinance of the City Council of City of Temple City, amending the municipal code to establish regulations for tobacco shops, e-cigarette, vaporizer stores, and closely related businesses.
Thank you. We move to item D, public hearing, first reading and introduction of ordinance number 13-976, amending the downtown specific plan to add mixed-use development standards and modify the requirements for multifamily and senior citizen housing projects. And we have a presentation by Jeffrey and Andrew.
And I will let Andrew do this presentation, and once again, we're both available to answer questions after.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Madam Mayor and council members. I'm going to begin by giving you kind of an overview of what this amendment to the downtown specific plan will involve. And just to start off, I wanted to let you know or give you an idea of what the rationale for this was. And the primary reason we're bringing this before you tonight is because this is called for in the housing element, which was recently adopted by the City Council. The secondary reason we're bringing this before you is that it will help to expand commercial and residential opportunities in the downtown. Now, just to kind of give you a refresher on the 2008-2014 housing element, it calls for several policy changes that will affect the downtown specific plan. And these policy changes, after we sent it to the California Department of Housing and Community Development, they're mandated by them. And before we can move on to the next round of the housing element, which would be this fall, we need to have every program that was in the housing element adopted. So this is one, and later on, and a future council meeting will be going over those other items. So the changes that the downtown specific plan needs to have made first involve allowing horizontal side-by-side commercial and residential uses with ground floor residential, establishing R3 densities for residential projects with no density cap for senior housing, eliminating CUP, that is conditional use permit requirements for residential projects, eliminating the 1 acre minimum lot size for mixed use. So these are all policy changes that have already been approved by the council, but now we need to take this action to actually include them in the specific plan. Now the other item that we're discussing are the design standards for mixed use development standards. And kind of part of the reason we're bringing this before you is because when we were going through the downtown specific plan, we realized that, you know, most of the standards that are there do not apply to mixed use. So we figured that if we're bringing this to you, we'll try to be more inclusive and include this as well, because mixed use is very essential for reaching our regional housing needs. So currently, there are no development standards for mixed use, and that essentially hinders if a developer comes to Temple City and they want to build a mixed-use project, it becomes difficult for them to do that. So these standards would help streamline the process and make the CUP process more objective, so that if a developer comes, they can say, all right, I see what are the steps that I need to follow through in order to possibly get that CUP. And also, importantly, it would help to ensure quality design. And also expand the availability of commercial, retail, dining, and residential uses as well. So just to be brief tonight, I'm just going to quickly summarize the areas that these development standards would cover. The first would be building height. Ground floor heights, that is helping to ensure that the storefronts are appealing and inviting so that we continue to have that attractive Main Street atmosphere that we currently have on Las Tunas. Bulk and massing, which mainly deals with the architectural features on the building so that it helps to look interesting for the viewer. Setback requirements, and these are important because they help to mitigate the impact that these possibly multi-story buildings might have on neighboring residential neighborhoods. And when we went through the research, we looked at maybe 5, 6, 7 other cities and took from those cities the best practices that they had in order to make sure that these projects don't impact the residential neighborhoods. Parking requirements, we made an attempt to streamline the parking requirements for mixed use, because currently right now a mixed use project would, the commercial component would have its own requirement for parking, and then the residential would as well. So we tried to make that a little bit easier. Open space, we currently, the downtown specific plan requires 5% of the property needing to have some kind of landscaping or open space, that is, and we increase that to 10%. Design incentives, and these are basically opportunities to reward good design. And finally, we include an exceptions clause in the guidelines, and this basically gives the Planning Commission and the City Council the flexibility that if a project meets the goals of the general plan, the goals of the specific plan, but maybe in some areas doesn't exactly fit within the standards that we're establishing tonight, it gives the Planning Commission and the City Council the flexibility to establish alternate design guidelines for a project.
Can you elaborate at all on the design incentives?
Mm-hmm. Mainly, so the first area of the design incentives are architectural character and massing. So we're looking at, you know, what we call 360-degree design. So not something that's just the facade, but it's looking at the entire building, ensuring that it's an attractive building from pretty much every point of view. Residential amenities. So we're looking at what kind of amenities are there for the residents of the residential component that make it an appealing place for people to want to live. Pedestrian-oriented design elements. This would include public spaces, places that people who are just visiting or passing through might want to stop and linger and look at the shops. And finally, it's conservation. And so we're rewarding designs that both are energy efficient and water efficient as well. And that would include the U.S. Green Building Council's leadership in energy and environmental design, the rating system. So if a project uses that rating system in their design, we would reward them with some kind of incentive.
They need to be certified.
Do they need to be certified?
You say uses a standard.
Yeah, it would be LEED Silver.
Silver.
Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question about the incentives?
Yeah, well, it kind of does. You know, it's buzzing around back here in the back of my mind is the Architectural Review Board kind of thing, which this isn't, and yet it has elements of it.
Basically, what we wanted to do is if a project comes in and is asking, we wanted to get something if we're giving either an FAR bonus or, let's say, the height bonus. We wanted something back in return. So we wanted to be sure we were either getting energy-efficient buildings, we were getting high-quality design, we were getting amenities for the residents that can help augment city facilities, or that these projects are very pedestrian-friendly, and so there's places for people to sit, and there's public art, and those type of features that make high-quality projects. And so we wanted, in return for giving them either extra height or an FAR bonus, we wanted something in return. So that's why it's set up that way. So it's not geared to be an architectural review, but that the commission and council ultimately have discretion that, yes, we're getting this great project, and so we're willing to give you back a little something else.
So if you have a recreational facility there and the building heights are cool and they've met all the other stuff, the setback requirements, mm-hmm. and the open space, the building can pretty much look like whatever the architect comes up with.
Correct. We're not dictating an architectural style. We're looking for 360-degree architecture, so that a lot of times you'll see, because people want to cut costs, they'll do a lot of work on the front facade, and then you have blank walls, basically, the other three sides. We want to ensure that these buildings, that great architecture is all sides of the building. We're not dictating a style. There's other design guidelines in the downtown specific plan that talk about a top and a base and a middle of a building. But we're not dictating a particular style.
So if somebody wanted to come in and build something that doesn't look like any of the other buildings downtown.
Well, it's discretionary because this would still require
a big glass cube.
Well, and it's still discretionary. Do they meet all the other guidelines? A lot of times glass cubes really don't have a top and a base and a middle, and we would still be looking at, is it compatible, you know, with downtown? So I don't think we would allow something that's totally out of the norm for what we would expect in our downtown. It just gives some flexibility to designers.
Finally, in conclusion, just to sum up what we're bringing before you tonight, the first goal of this ordinance is to implement the housing policies that were already adopted by you in the housing element. And then finally, through the design guidelines that we're including for mixed use, we're going to ensure that the city is going to be effectively ready in order to approve projects as they come. You know, so between those two things, I think this amendment pretty much covers everything we need.
Thank you. Okay, I'd like to open up the public hearing. Is there anyone who would like to speak on this issue?
Motion to close public hearing. Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Council comments? Councilmember Yu?
I think it's a good ordinance. It's required, and I think it leaves flexibility for creativity and yet encourages the development of new mixed use, although I really don't see anybody doing side by side, but you know, we'll leave it for the developers. Meaning residential and commercial side by side on Main Street, you know, we'll leave that up to their creativity.
I thought the implication was that it would be commercial downstairs and
residential. Actually, it actually removes that. It actually allows that side by side,
except in the city center, basically at Las Tunas and right. And Temple City. It just provides additional flexibility if you're, because sometimes towards the back, developers only want commercial spaces that are right. So deep, but if your lot's deeper, you could put residential on the ground floor in the back. So that would still qualify as side by side. Yeah.
Anything else?
No, I think it's a good.
Council Member Chavez?
No, as part of the City Code Review Standing Committee, I got a preview of this already. I think staff did a great job and makes a lot of sense, I think. And I think it's a good ordinance.
Council Member Viscar?
Supportive.
Mayor Pro Tem?
Yeah, I like to thank staff. I mean, we're talking about how do we re-energize our city, how do we re-energize our commercial areas, and I think the things that are coming into place here starts to allow different thinking. I mean, if you want something different, you have to think different. You can't want something different and have all the same basic rules in place. So I appreciate the effort coming forward on this, creative thinking that's gone into it. Thank you for that, and I think it's a good step in moving us forward. As Councilman you said, we may not see it today, but I think we're laying the groundwork for the future, and I think that's extremely important.
And I just concur with all my fellow council members, and I just can't say enough about it's so nice to be up here and having initiatives and ideas come from staff, and not, I think, for a long time, it was the other way around. So I very much appreciate that. Thank you. Okay, we're ready for a motion.
I'll move that we introduce ordinance number 13976 for first reading by title only, amending the downtown specific plan to add mixed-use development standards and modify the requirements for multifamily and senior citizen housing projects, that we waive further reading of ordinance number 13976, and that we schedule a second reading of ordinance number 13976 for August 6th of this year.
You have a second?
Second.
Okay,
Okay, I have no objection. The motion carries. City Clerk.
Ordinance number 13-976, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Temple City, amending the downtown specific plan to add mixed-use development standards and modify the requirements for multifamily and senior citizen housing projects.
Thank you. We move to item 10, communications none. We now recess to our successor agency, to the Temple City Community Redevelopment Agency meeting. May we have the roll call, please?
Agency member Chavez?
Here.
Agency member Vizcarra?
Here.
Agency member Yu?
Here.
Vice Chair Bloom?
Here.
Chairman Sternquist?
Here. Okay, item 3, consent calendar.
Move it.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Hearing no objections. The motion has been carried. Item 4, unfinished business, none. New business, none. Communications, none. Public comments, is there anyone who would like to make a public comment?
Move to close public comments.
Second.
Item 8, update from our executive director and agency council.
None.
None. 9, matters from agency members, none. Closed session, none. We are in adjournment.
That was very efficient.
Thank you. We move back to our regular council meeting. And we are on item 12, actions taken by city as successor agency to the Temple City Community Redevelopment Agency, none. Item 13, update from our city manager.
Madam Mayor and members of the council, just wanted to wish you, Madam Mayor, happy birthday. Birthdays are very special, and today happens to be your birthday, and we hope you had a good day. So we, on behalf of staff, we'll congratulate you.
Should we all sing? Should we all sing?
Yes.
Thank you.
Let's go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear mayor. Happy birthday to you.
And many more.
There you go.
Not bad.
Thank you very much.
We practiced a long time.
Don't give up your day job.
Thank you. Anything else?
Yes, I do. Just wanted to also let everybody know that we had a great meeting with the County of Los Angeles Library. And as a matter of fact, the library needs assessment survey is actually on the Temple City website now. So we will encourage the public to actually go on to our website at www.templecity.us and actually fill out the survey. And it's a very inclusive and well thought out survey, which we had. The survey translated by Stella Yu, she's done a phenomenal job on all the activities that she's actually worked on in programs for us. So I think that's really going to be the bilingual component that will be coming through. But again, it's really important that we get your feedback, we get your assessments, and that we get those surveys completed. Tomorrow night, you can come over to Temple City Park, and you'll have Raymond Michael basically playing tribute to Elvis Presley and listen to your Presley tunes. And also the following week on July 24th, you can see the Silverados as they perform their country hits from contemporary artists like Toby Keith, Carrie Underwood, and Miranda Lambert. The concerts are free and open to the public, and they all start at 7 p.m. On July 30th, the council will hold a special study session to discuss the new city logo and to also recommend the economic development work plan for the next 5 years. The meeting starts at 7 o'clock here at the council chambers. And finally, on August 7th, the newly formed Public Arts Commission will consider proposed design concepts for the new public art installments on Roseby Boulevard. Specifically, the commission will select for the council 3 artists to develop 2 sculptures, 23 art walk pavers, and 4 mural tile seating walls. The meeting is open to the public, and it starts at 7 o'clock in the community room at Live Oak Park. And just lastly, wanted to also advise the public that, as you may recall, in January, the City Council submitted three grant applications to Metro for funding for the Las Tunas project. Our total request for the 3 grants was about $7.9 million, and we were notified a couple weeks ago by Metro that they will be recommending in September to the Board of Supervisors that we be awarded up to $6.9 million. So that basically gives us the complete funding for the Las Tunas project. And it'll be really exciting to see a lot of movement. So expect to have staff come back with a staff report to award phase two of the design services to FTS to be able to complete that design, and then continue with the public meetings to be able to basically kick the process off. So that concludes my items for tonight, Mayor and members of the council. Thank you.
Thank you. Move to item 14, council reports regarding ad hoc or standing committee meetings. Do we have any?
I have one.
Councilmember Chavez?
I'll report out on the school district's city standing committee. Mayor Pro Tem Bloom and I met with board members Nolenberg and board member Smith of Temple City Unified School District at our regular meeting. Three items were on the agenda. First was to get an update on Measure S facility bond projects from the school district. They reported out that the board has approved the first issuance of $40 million and that will start moving forward early August. The primary facilities that will be looked at in that first issuance will be, of course, technological advances in the school, as well as the track and field, two-story building for classrooms, as well as the high school pool. If you need information on that, you can go to the Temple City Unified School District website, and they will start having more information on that, as well as a public outreach program to let the community know of the progress. We also gave an update on the Safe Route to School projects. We did tonight, we had an award of a consultant services for design and engineering to proceed with the Safe Route to School project. And Mark, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think construction is due to be completed by summer of next year.
That is correct.
And so it will begin, after tonight's action, we will begin with the design engineering and proceed with that. So it is on its way, so that's the school. And we will we be working with the schools and the individual principals to let them know as the projects get going so that the disruption to their everyday program will be at a minimum. Last item we discussed, and that was since it's very close in time, and that is the 4th of July issues that come up every year. We had an open discussion or beginning discussion on perhaps future options for 4th of July celebrations. Talked about perhaps even hosting a celebration at the high school in lieu of, or to give our community other options in celebrating the 4th. So we'll have further discussions on that throughout the year. We heard earlier about the administrative sites, things that we started doing this year to curb the illegal fireworks, and this is just one of those other things. One of the reasons we approached the school district is that they have, of the 12 applications that we approve every year, four of them do come from the high school. So they do have a vested interest, of course, in the groups and organizations and how they raise money. And so we decided to try to put our heads together to come up with maybe other options they can use to raise those funds without causing any harm to our city that is brought by mostly the illegal fireworks. So. And other than that, Councilmember Bloom, if I've missed anything.
You got it.
Okay. Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you for reminding me. Some of you may be aware the school district actually was awarded recently, or not awarded, but received a $250,000 donation from an alumnus who remains anonymous, and which is obviously going to be, well, we use for outdated technology and such. And the same alumnus has offered an additional $100,000 if the high school can raise a matching funds. And so the high school has started to do that. They have a timeline of September 30th, 2013. It's my understanding they've raised about $50,000 of that $100,000. So if they can raise another $50,000 by the end of September, they will get another $100,000 from this alumnus. So the information is on their website. I told them that I would mention that this evening. Then those of you who are watching our council meeting, if you're interested in making donations, you can get a hold of the high school or go to the Temple City website and get the information on that. It's probably a worthy cause, obviously. I think something that not only will help the school district, but and as a byproduct, you know, help the city as well. So
it's also on the high school.
It's on the high school website,
and
the district website. So either website you can go to, and you can get the information on how to make a donation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Could have got up and done that on your own. got on the camera and, you know, got some publicity. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay. Councilmember Viscar?
One important meeting that we had was the council chamber renovation. And as you could see, it was on the agenda tonight. It looks like we're well on our way to proceeding, and I think we're looking at beginning the work in the fall. So in September. Well, kind of qualifies as fall. So
I looked at Jerry, so I wanted to make it.
Yeah. So we're underway. We came up, I think, with a nice design. This place is going to look a lot different, and much more. It's going to retain the same flavor, but it's going to be updated, if that makes any sense. It's going to be bright and shiny and much prettier and much more user-friendly. So one day soon we'll provide some renderings, I think, for the public. So we're there. That's it.
Okay. Council Member Yu?
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. As the city manager has already mentioned, there is a library survey out there. Last week, the mayor, as our LA County library commissioner, and myself, representative with the Civic Center Standing Committee, we, along with the Temple City's school district board member, Nolan Burke, met with the LA County librarian, Margaret Todd, and her staff to kick off the library survey, and which is really a precursor to the possibility of building a brand new library. So like the city managers has said, the survey is available online, and the hard copy is available at the city hall counter as well as the library. In bilingual, and there'll be the community will be getting certain members of the community selected will be getting a letter from the mayor inviting them to a certain focus group meetings. Yeah. Any additional comments on that?
I do have my meeting tomorrow with the library commission, so will definitely reiterate every time I go the importance of a new library in Temple City. And I have to say, there's four people on this library commission, representatives, other council members, and all four either have a brand new library or a portion of a new library, a new children's library or a new teen library. So definitely is a place to be to emphasize how important a new library would be to our city. So I'm looking forward to that meeting tomorrow. Okay. Also, Mayor Pro Tem?
Nothing on the standing committee or ad hocs.
Hey, just a couple of things. The mosquitoes are proliferating as we speak, and as the weather warms up, there are more of them. And the infestation was originally located in El Monte, and at our last meeting this past Friday, there were three dead crows that were carrying the virus in Arcadia. So please be sure to not let any water stand in your plants, water from the roots, not from above, and so just keep an eye out if you have any, see any dead crows. The website, Los Angeles County Mosquito and Vector Control website has some really good information on how you can report, and also is it Charter that has carries our cable? They have a great feed that continues to go through that'll give you all the latest information on where the mosquitoes have been located, and so take a look at that if you get a chance.
But there's a dead crow. Does somebody come out and pick it up?
Yes, there's actually a, they'd like you to report it as soon as you see it. Don't wait, because I guess there's a 24-hour period where they can actually
take a blood sample.
Yeah, take the samples when it's still viable enough to give them the maximum information. So, okay. And one last thing. I apologize for being late this evening. I was at the Relay for Life fundraiser at the Crest having a Coke. And when I asked someone what time it was, they said, oh, you still have plenty of time. And actually, it was about 10 minutes to get here on time. And my car was blocked in. And there must have been 100 people at the Crests. And no one would say whose car it was. So actually got driven here in a big red truck. And I don't know who the person was, but they did get me here just a little bit later than I would have liked to. I do want to ask our city manager if he would be so kind as to put up these feet at City Hall, and hopefully we can plaster them throughout City Hall. And it's actually just a little motivation and incentive to get everybody on board to either participate or donate. And so these are the feet of already of city council members or city staff, our city family, that have donated. And I personally would like to thank our city attorney for his gracious donation. I think I bugged him a little bit, but it only took one email, actually. So thank you very much, Eric. And Jose also for contributing and continuing to get some more donations, and staff. So these are going to be up there. If you have donated and you don't have a foot, please talk to Jose, and then I'll verify it and make sure that your foot gets up. So hopefully we'll have everybody, even if you donate a dollar, you get a foot. Okay? And if anyone in the audience or anyone out there in the public doesn't know how to contribute to the Relay for Life event on August 27th, you can come into City Hall, you can donate 50 cents, and we'll give you a foot. And you can put it up and be part of our Relay for Life team. So we so far have raised almost $6,000 with our city team. So, and a total for the event now is about $21,000. So we're doing really well as a city. And I think that's about it. And
Madam Mayor, if I may add, I think also for the public, I mean, if you can also go to the city's website. And also there's a whole press release in the middle of the website, and you just basically click on the link in the press release that takes you straight to the Temple City Relay for Life website. So,
great. And if you'd like to take a foot for a neighbor and collect some funds from them too, please do so. And I know I've been a real pest about this, but it's such a wonderful cause. And actually on July 27th to the day is the day my dad passed away. So it's a very heartfelt event for me. And my dad was a survivor for 5 years after being given six weeks to live. And we were just not ready to let him go. And with the help of the American Cancer Society, my father lived almost five incredible years with advanced lung cancer. So I would like everybody out there who is a cancer victim and survivor to continue to have more birthdays like I'm having today. So thank you. And I think we have item 16, reimbursement of expenses to city officials for conduct of city business. Did I miss something?
We didn't do 15.
I thought that's what we just did.
Yeah, we were doing the ad hoc committee.
We were doing the
ad hoc
committee.
Oh, okay. Well, I just skipped to.
I was wondering how you got on that.
Because I moved fast forward. It's 10:15. Okay. So we moved to item 15, council item separate from the city manager's regular agenda, and I just combined mine with my ad hoc report on mosquitoes. So I'm done. Council member Chavez.
Nothing.
Council member Vizcarra.
A question, Mr. City Manager. What has happened to the public art assessment for new construction? Or did we ever finalize that, the percentage? Remember, we're...
Oh, no, that'll be coming back to the actual commission. They'll be making a recommendation to the council for approval. So that's part of their work plan.
I want to be sure that that doesn't get prolonged too much because time is passing.
We want that on board.
And I attended the last meeting, and that was not on the radar.
They're focused right now, I think, on the artists, but that is one of the items that is actually high up on the list.
All right. Thank you. That's it.
Councilmember Yu.
Oh, thank you, Madam Mayor. Just wanted to re-emphasize one thing that City Manager had mentioned very quickly. It didn't make a big deal of it, but the MTA funding, and that's huge, actually, for a small city like us getting the $6.9 million. In comparison, the MTA funding that we got for Rosemead Boulevard, I think, is only like 2.8, right?
2.25.
I mean, this is county. This is like three times what we got. So, I mean, I really want to commend staff and the city manager and staff for working so hard and doing such a great job in getting more and more grants and funds for the city. So, good job.
No, it's a team effort. I think council, without your support, honestly, and the resources, there's no way we would have been able to submit such a comprehensive approach, application to begin with. And I think it's, you guys being available on for special meetings, it really, really pushed this. The community basically stepping up and giving us input as we went through. I think we kicked this project off in October. Grant application was due in January. And I think in between New Year's and Christmas, we were having a special meeting, to basically flush out all the issues so that we can submit by the January deadline. So, it's a team effort.
The public participation we had was incredible. Community meeting is also huge. So,
Vince, for the benefit of the audience, I'm not sure we're clear about what that money is really for. Could you?
Well, I love that.
Well, it's actually the construction of the Las Tunas project, and based on the preliminary designs that were approved already. So we're going to we have a fully funded project. We'll have to put in $1 million like we did for Rosemead Boulevard, but that's not too bad. I mean, if we're basically
separate grants, right?
Correct.
Yeah,
that's been the topic of a lot of conversation in town. So I wanted to be sure that people knew that
this
that
is for
specifically
the
is what
correct
that
for Las Tunas.
Okay, Mayor Pro Tem.
I just want to compliment staff. I think the presentations on the issues, your visuals are very good. They're very clear and readable. I think for the audience to read them also. And so I appreciate that. There's a marked increase or level of understanding that the people in the television audience and the place here needs to see that stuff. We have the opportunity to read this stuff ahead of time, but thank you.
That's it? Okay, additional public comments on items not listed on the agenda, item 17. Is there anyone? Sure.
Good evening, council members and mayor, Jerry Jambazian. I was listening to City Manager Polito's report tonight, but I noticed on the handy-dandy Facebook page from the city that there is a public trolley meeting on the 24th, and I'm just a little concerned about that, is why you schedule two things on the same night. And I don't understand it, and why that would happen when you want to have a wide participation, why you would have the concerts on the same night as the trolley presentation, the routes.
Actually, okay.
We went back and forth trying to find a date to have a joint meeting with the Parks and Rec Commission and the Public Safety Commission, and it seems the only day that they were both able to get together was Wednesdays, which are their normal meeting nights. Because of the concert, though, we did schedule the meeting at 6 o'clock instead of 7:30, the normal time. And I apologize, Jerry, that information should have been given to the city manager ahead of time to report out, and I forgot about it until tonight. So for the audience, there will be a public meeting to review the recommendations from the consultant for the fixed route shuttle. These are preliminary recommendations. As I mentioned, the Parks and Rec Commission and the Public Safety Commission will jointly review the recommendations and then provide additional comments, and then a final draft will be presented to staff and finally to the City Council, probably in August, late August.
Okay. Thank you. Listening to Councilmember Bloom tonight, and listening to Andrew twice now, I'd like to compliment him on his presentations also. I think it's very, very well done, very professional, so I appreciate that. I think there was one other thing, but I can't remember what it was now, but, Councilmember Viscara talking about the grant money that was for Los Tunas Project. I'd just like to offer a little pun that we backed into it. So thank you very much.
Okay, looks like we move to is there anyone else? Okay.
Move to close. Second. Public comment.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Hearing no objections, it's been carried. We move to item 18, closed session none. And we are now in adjournment until, what's our date?
August 6th.
August 6th. Wow. Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Wait, we have a special.